It's full of hooks, but there's no traditional pop song form that is the chorus that everybody sings along
full
to.
Full of hooks. That's a hook. The bass line. Do, 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 do. That's a hook.
Wait, how's it go?
Do, 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 do.
Oh, that bass line. Sorry, I didn't know which one you were talking about. Okay. Welcome back to Dead Wax.
We're listening to one of our favorite bands today, Tame Impala.
This is The Less I Know, The Better.
There's so much to talk about.
I don't know where to start. This song, obviously we're fanboys, so, you know, this is just gonna be, we have to just get that right off the plate. If you want a, you know, critique
this
about
is a bias.
How this is a blah, blah, no, this is straight up bias.
This is a biased view.
This is a biased review of the song. So much about the song is incredible. The thing that I have to point out, just out of the gate, is it is not traditional pop song form. It is not verse, chorus, verse, chorus. It's A, B, A, B, C. And the A's are not choruses. It's not a big refrain that everybody sings along and it's the chorus part that everybody knows. It's not. It's more like Beatles form where there's an A section like Hard Day's Night. Is actually much more like Hard Day's Night than it is like a 2000s pop song.
There's the sort of opening riff. There's A section, which is kind of like the chorus, right? That most people think of as the chorus.
But it's not a chorus.
It's not a chorus.
It's an A section.
And then there's a B section, and then there's a C section. And the way that he weaves all of these sections in and out of each other and plays with your expectations is so masterful.
He also, wait, sorry, you're saying weaving those parts in and out of each other. I think a great example is this guitar line. Which
that happens over different chords.
Over different chords and
different
over different
sections of the song.
But he's like remixing and mashing up his own ideas over different sections of the song. So it sounds familiar still because we hear those parts.
Yes.
But they're introduced in new ways. It's full of hooks, but there's no traditional pop song form that is the chorus that everybody sings along to.
Full of hooks. That's a hook. The bass line. Do, 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 do. That's a hook.
Wait, how's it go?
Do, 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 do.
Oh, that bass line. Sorry, I didn't know which one you were talking about. Okay.
I want to approach this a couple different ways.
Okay.
So you just talked about the form.
Yep.
I want to talk about the harmony, the lyrics, the melody, the production, but I want to start with the sounds.
Yes.
Okay? Let's just like, in cooking show form, put all of the bowls on the table that he's using. Okay?
These ingredients, his sonic capabilities as an engineer, I think surpass even his abilities as a songwriter.
He mixed this.
That is incredible
to
me.
It's insane that he mixed this song.
I think
he's playing everything. When I realized, when this came out, I was like, this mix is insane. And then I looked it up and saw that he mixed it.
This became my B.
Yeah.
Right? And when I'm A-B-ing mixes, this mix was the thing that I comped every single mix to for probably like 6 years.
It's a
I was
great
using
mix.
This mix. Because what's interesting about it is a modern electro mix of acoustic instruments.
And it sounds old. It harkens back to it does the old but new thing so well. I mean, just like his voice kind of sounds like Lennon, but it's not. And he's his own thing. The mix kind of does that.
Listen to this drum sound. Listen to the drums. That snare drum is so present, so in your face, so compressed, so clean, and yet so crunchy and old sounding.
Intangible, because it's a real snare.
It's a real snare drum.
So, okay, so to place the bowls on the table, there's the drums, mm-hmm. okay? Mm-hmm. Which is amazing. We just talked about the drum sound. There's the bass. So let's just list everything in this song right now.
There's the EP piano sound.
Okay.
That beautiful, sparkly, chorusy kind of piano that is like a 90s piano sound.
It's the bell type piano sound. It's, the tubular actually, bell kind of.
It's an FM, I think it originally developed an FM synthesizer.
And play, let's just point out where exactly you're talking about. Play where that's
that. That is that glassy kind of FM synthesis
That's
sound.
One synth.
Yes.
Now play before that comes in. There's another synth, which is like a Paddy synth.
Yeah. So you're talking
like
about
halfway through the intro. On the left. So right there, those are only three sounds.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And there's a filter on the drums.
Right.
But the filter is such that
it's cutting out the lows.
It's cutting out the lows, but it doesn't. If you just That could be the drum sound for the whole song.
But instead, he ups the ante.
And he adds in the lows, which make the whole song. It sounds like you were listening to the intro standing outside of a room, and then the door opens
mm-hmm.
when that FM
synthesizer
comes in, and the lows and the drums come in. Okay, so bass, drums. We got those two synths. We have the guitar going.
Right.
We have that part.
Yep.
So that's one guitar.
Yep. And
there might be an additional pad mm-hmm. that's sort of like you feel, but
there's another
don't
pad
hear.
That is hard to hear, but okay, it's kind of playing those chords. It's filling out the harmony a little bit.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's his vocal, which his vocal sound is so iconic.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know how to make that. Is it two? Is it three? Is it a double or a triple?
It definitely sounds multi-tracked. Let's listen to this.
It's definitely more than one.
There's obviously reverb on it.
It's a lot of reverb.
There's a lot of compression on it.
Right.
And it sounds like it's high pass.
And is it, so when people double vocals, there's so many ways to skin that cat. You can hard pan them. You can go right down the center.
This doesn't sound hard panned to me.
It sounds pretty mono.
Yeah.
It sounds pretty down the center.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so there's the vocals. There's real strings that sound like.
Where do you hear the real strings?
Play in the middle of verse two, or verse three, after the first B section.
Yeah, and what's interesting is the mix is so compressed.
Yeah.
That it's like whenever there's a down moment, the strings pop through, and
right.
then as soon as there isn't, the strings fade to the background.
So that could be a sample. That mm-hmm. could be real. It sounds like hi-fi strings. It mm-hmm. doesn't really sound like, you know, a synth string moment. And then there's delays on stuff, right?
Yeah.
There's
yeah.
just like production moments where he'll trigger a delay on the vocal.
But what's interesting about this mix is you could list out all of those things and somebody else could put those things in their mix.
Yeah.
But what makes this so special is how everything is treated, right?
Mm.
It is the subtle processing. It is the dynamics processing, the EQ, a little bit of saturation on a lot of those things, right? So there's a little bit of some extra harmonics and some grime on those pianos and on that bass, especially there's some top end saturation on the bass sounds.
Yeah.
It's his treatment and mixing and harmonics processing of those sounds that make all of the ingredients so fresh and interesting and retro and all the things, right? It's his processing of those things that makes it incredible.
So to transition to a different topic, I think what's cool, another thing that's cool about this song is the things that he chooses to put in the spotlight, like the groove. What's reason number one why this song works? It feels great. You know what I mean? It's dancey. It feels cool. Reason number two, the sounds. Every sound is like interesting and makes you think of a million things. But then when you dig deeper, you get to the melody. Like the melody is not up front.
Mm-mm.
You know what I mean? But the melody is amazing.
And that's the other thing that's amazing about his work, I think, is he, you know, indie rock is kind of, I don't want to say famous for putting the vocals in the background, but if you listen to a pop mix, the vocals are right here.
Right up front.
They're like right here. And this is more like an indie rock mix where the vocals are a little bit receding into the background, yeah, a little bit more verby, a little bit more spaced out. But the mix is more punchy than an indie rock mix.
Yeah.
It's like pop sensibilities plus indie rock traditions of leveling.
You can hear the melody and the lyrics, but they're not in your face. Mm-hmm. You have to look through,
yep,
the groove and the sounds, mm-hmm, and the mix. So the melody. Can we just dissect this melody?
Yeah, let's dissect the melody. You want me to take the chords? 1, 2, 3. What do you like about that melody?
Sorry.
Yeah.
It is the perfect balance of expected and unexpected, mm-hmm, of development. The note choice, what notes he chooses to sing on which chords.
Interesting.
So right there, we have a third in the bass, and the chord is like a five, right? We're going, yeah, from a six to a five in first inversion, to a one, okay? Mm-hmm. So those are all cool notes, by the way, over this chord, over six.
Mm-hmm.
There's a little bit of tension in that melody.
Yeah.
And then, so now we have the third of the five in the bass and a seven in the root to the seven. So now we have this beautiful movement where the bass is going up and the melody is going down.
Yeah.
And then over the one chord, he's singing the six, which is like my favorite note, my favorite color tone. Right?
Yes.
It's not a one, it's not a root, third, or fifth, it's a sixth.
You know what's so interesting about that? He does that again at the end.
Yes.
He puts the sixth in the four chord.
Right.
Let's listen to the
There's a lot of sixths in the harmony here.
C section. So that's an A major,
right,
but there's an F sharp in it.
Yes.
So there's a six in that, which is exactly what he's doing in the intro with that six,
yes,
over the one.
Yes. And then how the melisma that he uses coming out of the melody.
Melisma?
Have you not heard that?
What's a melisma?
A melisma is like an articulation, like a vocal, you know, like Mariah Carey was a very melismatic singer.
Oh my goodness. Why?
It's,
yes,
just such a beautiful, it's beautifully sung. Yeah, the whole thing just fits together so beautifully. And then you get even a layer below the melody to the lyric.
Yeah.
The lyric.
Wait, sorry. Before we leave the melody,
because
I have to, we have to talk about his harmony for a second. We just grazed over it. I think the thing that makes his harmony so interesting is that he's constantly adding extensions, but they're always different extensions. And and he's not stuck in like, oh, that's a major sevens guy. Like, he doesn't do that. He's always adding one interesting note, one interesting extension that gives you just the right amount of color. So
yes,
it doesn't sound like Steely Dan. It,
right,
sounds like indie rock, but with a little bit of extra color on top.
Here would be the same chords with different extensions.
Let's hear it.
Same chords with different extensions. Completely different feeling.
That's jazz school extensions.
I'm just saying,
right,
extensions matter.
That's... Extensions really matter. Extensions meaning the notes on top of the triad that,
yes,
you add
the
to
notes
your chord.
Extra from a triad.
And, so,
and also the length that he's playing each chord. It's,
right,
not... It's 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Yes.
That's interesting.
And can we talk about the obvious thing now, of course, that I think everybody wants to hear about and it stands out to us.
Yeah.
Is that chord pattern that you just chose.
Yeah.
With the rhythm of the bass. oh. and where the bass lands. Bum, ba-dum, bum, bum. Which is those bum bums
yeah.
are on 3-4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Yes. And what's interesting about that pattern is landing on 4 yeah. like that, landing before the downbeat, right before the chord changes.
Yeah.
It's as if the bass is playing a different song than the
right.
chords.
Right. And it works because the bass is a strong melody. Like when your bass line is that hooky, it gives you such a strong foundation to build on top of because it's cohesive within itself.
Do me a favor.
Yeah.
I'm going to play the chords.
Yeah.
Play the bass line, but as it should have been written, as Hans Greuner
you
would
mean
have
like...
written it. Yes, yes.
Okay.
Ready? 1, 2, 3, and. It like takes all of the soul out
right.
of the song. It takes all of the funk out of the song.
Yes.
The fact that he just takes those two notes and he's like, nope, we're gonna put those on 3-4 instead. It's it the last band who did that, I think, really, really well. Do you know who I'm gonna say?
No.
It's those two kids who
oh,
have
MGMT.
That song. MGMT.
Yeah.
What's that bass line? It reminds me of that bass line.
Yeah.
It's the same kind of vein.
Electric feel?
Yes, electric feel.
On 1-2.
Yes.
Ooh, girl.
Yeah.
Shock me like an electric
feel.
Yeah.
It's got that same kind of boom, boom, but in the wrong place mm-hmm. that you don't expect.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Let's talk about the lyrics. Okay.
Let's talk about them.
I think the first, I like lyrics that don't sound like lyrics. And what's cool about the way he writes lyrics is if you read them down, there's such a beautiful, cool story that's relatable. But they pop out every once in a while. He uses, did you hear this? When he uses the word bullshit, in the C section.
Yeah.
That's the first place where if I'm just listening passively, the lyrics kind of stick out. To me, that just puts the spotlight on the lyric. When you use a word that kind of is unusual or shouldn't be there, it grabs listeners' attention and says like, hey, I'm saying something over here, which is cool. And then that would sort of lead me to pull up the lyrics or listen to the lyrics. And it's just, it's a cool story. He's using cool words. It's not bullshit placeholder lyrics. You know what I mean? He's using someone's name. He said, pull yourself together. You should try your luck with Heather. Then I heard they slept together. The less I know, the better. It's relatable. You know
yeah.
what I mean?
Yeah.
I don't want to know. What guy hasn't felt that at some point?
Yeah, it's all the choices definitely feel intentional. I think that's one thing that is consistent across his entire catalog. Is everything feels meticulously crafted
yeah.
to be just what he wants.
Yes, it doesn't sound like he's settled anywhere.
Anywhere.
It doesn't sound like he's made any compromises. It sounds like he's worked on this until it was exactly the way he wanted it.
The other thing I think is special about this tune is the use of surprise, which we're seeing kind of all over the place, right? And I think great music is often...
expectation balanced with surprise.
Expectation balanced with surprise. In balance without. And for me, the thing about this song that nails the element of surprise is this, in the B section, right? It's after this first intro that we do, that we hear multiple times where we're in this world. Right?
Yeah.
We're in here. And then he goes...
yeah.
In the B section.
Yeah.
Now...
can we play that? Can you play that moment?
Here we go. And there's a 9 extension on that, right?
And also, again, the melody notes that he chooses over that chord. The sharp 11. It's so hip.
So here's what he's doing. We're here. We've been in 6 world. Minor 6-1. Minor 6-1. Diatonic land.
And then
we're
the sun
in
comes out.
Land.
And now we're starting on the 1.
Now the sun is out. We're starting on the 1. Oh, sorry.
This is the first non-diatonic chord we've heard in the song.
Correct. We're getting that flat seven.
Mm-hmm.
And the flat seven comes after we've been hearing 1-6, 1-6 for like a minute.
Yeah.
And then we get this beautiful flat seven. Talk about surprise.
Yeah.
It totally shakes you from the harmonic world that we've been in.
Yes.
And introduces a completely
new color,
a new set of textures. Completely shakes you from the harmonic world that we've been in for like a minute. Introduces new colors, new textures, and feels amazing.
Okay.
Perfect use of surprise.
Another brilliant use of surprise. Before he goes to the C section, we're in the second B section, and he plays this thing. So you think you're going back to the intro, but no, you go to a new room in the house.
Here we go, let's listen to that.
Okay.
So he is remixing.
He's teasing, he's remixing himself.
He's remixing himself and he's playing with samples and the idea of sampling. It's such a smart composition and such a smart song.
And it's also a device as old as time. I mean, this is all over classical music, is people taking a theme from this movement and using it in a different context in this movement. It's just, it's brilliant. It's like reading a novel and the novelist planting seeds throughout that come into play later.
I think that's a really good point, because a lot of great composers, even if they're writing pop songs, the core of their compositional style is motivic composition, right? I mean, the classic example being Yesterday, right? Yesterday, bum ba bum.
Yesterday, all my troubles seem so far away.
That's another example, motivic composition.
Right.
You have a little idea that repeats over and over and over again in the song.
Yes, to expound on. Right.
So, by the time you've heard 10 seconds of that song, you've heard bum, 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 four times.
In different contexts.
And so when that happens again, when he repeats that verse for the second time, you feel like, I can sing this. I can sing along.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's this idea that you've already heard four times. That's really great composers use micro motivic compositional techniques.
And they
like
set
that.
Up expectations. Another one. If I don't play anything and you've never heard this song before,
you're gonna go,
you're guessing. Well, you're guessing what the answer is to the first question.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And so I think that's what a lot of great music does, is it sort of lays this path out for you, forces you to guess how the path is going to resolve, and then resolves it in a way that's somehow what you expected, but also somehow what you didn't expect.
I think a lot of folks are interested in the bass sound in particular. One of the questions that we got from the community, this is from Alex Coelho, what makes Tame Impala's bass sound so good? There's another person wondering about the bass. What makes the bass line?
Hobgoblin 8890.
Hobgoblin, what makes the bass line so awesome in The Less I Know, the Better? Can we give folks just a... So the answer is, we don't know.
Well, we talked about the sound and we talked about the line. Both are awesome, both for different reasons.
But let's talk a little bit about the processing on the bass sound itself, sonically.
There's distortion on it.
There's some distortion, but I think what's interesting about this... So here's what's interesting. The sub bass is actually very clean and very pure. If you were to cut everything out, say below 110 hertz, you would hear a very loud, very present, very clear.
Fundamental. Yeah.
Which means he's probably using some kind of parallel processing techniques on the bass.
Right.
Or multiband compression or multiband saturation or something like that.
He could have, one way you might achieve this bass sound would be to play the line DI right into your interface.
Mm-hmm.
And then to either re-amp that bass sound through distortion or through an amp. So you have the same signal run through two different processings. Or use some type of plug-in saturation, like decapitator or something to get that the grainy top end.
What immediately comes to mind, speaking of saturation plugins, I've been really into Fab Filters, Saturn plugin recently.
Yeah.
And what's interesting about Saturn is it's multi-band saturation. So you can add a band for your top end, say everything above 200, and you can run it through old tape style saturation, really gunk it up. But then you can add just a little bit of compression and keep your lows super clean and clear. This is what it sounds like to me. Who knows if he's using Decapitator or Saturn or some parallel EQ thing. But the point is, he's clearly treating different frequency bands of the bass sound with different harmonic saturating
and
tools.
And what makes all this so cool and what's so difficult to achieve is that it sounds analog. You know what I mean? Regardless of how he's making all of this, it sounds tangible and real and tube. You know what I mean? He's just a masterful engineer and mixer.
Ryan, what's a song that you've been listening to recently? What do you think folks at home should know about?
Okay, my friend, shout out to Lizzie McAlpine and Philip Etherington introduced me to Holly Humberstone. And there's a song of hers called Scarlett that I like a lot. We go together like bad British weather, and the one day I made plans.
So go hell for leather, I know that it's out of my hands. What about Speaking you? Of DX7s or that FM synthesis 90s piano sound, I gotta do a little Amy Grant action.
Wow.
I've been going deep on Amy Grant. It's so good, man. If you like
just really good.
Vibing out to great 80s compositions with amazing 80s production.
Yeah.
This is creme de la creme 80s fun. Amy Grant, I hear these songs. It's so good. Like
Did you say the name of his song?
The name of the song that I love is Good For Me. Of course, there's Baby Baby, which is the one everybody knows. But listen to the first track on that album, Good For Me. Amazing synthesizers, awesome beat it guitar, hair metal-y kind of guitar shit going on top of it. The groove is fun. It's a slow groove, but it feels really good. There's some amazing drum production. It's just a great track. I love Amy Grant.
Guys, thank you so much for listening. Even though it's just Jack and I here today, it's been fun hanging out with you. This has been Dead Wax.
We'll see you next time. Bye, everybody.